Good morning everyone and welcome to the third lecture of our online lecture series. This is Juma Ghosh, curator at Nehru Science Center, Mumbai. We are holding this week-long lecture series where we will help the students to explore various career opportunities in future if they choose to work in the frontiers of science. Today's speaker, Professor Vandana Nalal, will be talking about the future opportunities for Indian students in INO project. Let me take this opportunity to introduce Professor Nalal. Professor Vandana Nalal has obtained her PhD in nuclear physics from TIFR in 1994. Then she joined as visiting fellow at Argonne National Laboratory in USA. In 1998, she joined as a faculty member in TIFR. She has also been visiting professor at University of Illinois, Chicago, Michigan State University in USA. She has collaborated both nationally and internationally. She is leading the national effort of feasibility study for search for neutrinoless double beta decay, which is a part of the INO project. Presently, she is holding the position of joint chair of the BRC TIFR Heavy Iron Accelerator Facility, as well as the post of General Secretary of Indian Physics Association. She has been part of the public outreach program of TIFR for long. With these words, I would like to thank Professor Vandana Nalal for accepting our invitation for this lecture, and I want to hand over the mic to her.
Thank you so much for the invitation and for the nice introduction. So let me now first start by sharing my screen. So let's get this right. So I hope you all can see my screen now. Can someone confirm the screen is visible? Juma, you are muted. Can you please just check things fine?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So a very warm good morning to all of you on the eve of this International Women's Day. And I want to do, I know that the lecture series is about the future opportunities for Indian girl students in mega science projects. So INO is one of the mega science project, and I would like to give you a flavor of why we study neutrinos and what all you can do when you want to do or pursue the research in the INO. So let me just start by this poster for the mega science, which is the from micro to macro, and you all have seen it because this was a great initiative by Government of India among and all other associated bodies. And as you can see that when you want to look for something which is tiny as whatever is happening inside the nucleus or inside these tiny particles like neutrinos, you need the big equipments. So that's what makes it mega science, because you need to plan it. It requires a lot of engineering, it requires a lot of physics, and it's learning about these particles also tells you a lot about what is happening in the entire universe. So in that sense, it connects from micro to macro. So just a word about it, about also the International Day of Women and Girls in Science. I don't know many, some of you are aware of it. In 2016, United Nations declared that 11th February will be celebrated as International Day of Women and Girls in Science. This is because it has become more and more apparent to people. It was always there, but now it's become more apparent, and efforts are done towards bridging the gender gap in STEM, that is science, technology, engineering and mathematics. And I hope that things would be easier for all of you coming in now in this generation, and maybe in another 10 years time when you are reaching the peaks of your careers, we will not have to talk about gender gaps. But today I will not talk more about it. I'll come back to the science. So if you go back and look at 19th and 20th century, the discovery and pursuit of science has always been a passion with the human race. So as you know, the chemists discovered and classified elements. So there was a valence and grouping of elements. Concept of atomic number was introduced. Molecular weight was obtained, and we had a periodic table of elements. The physicists discovered the structure of atoms. They were looking at the characteristic X-rays, emissions and absorption of light, ultraviolet light and X-rays. The ionization led to the discovery of electron, and it was known that electrons are light charged particles, negatively charged, and the atomic number also explained the periodic table. The unsolved puzzle still remained that since the atom as a whole was neutral, if there are electrons, there must be something which is positively charged. Where is that positive charge? And since electrons were light, what is it giving the mass to the atom? And that led to the discovery of nuclei. So largely when we look at nuclei and particles, our study, the approach is kind of nicely presented in this cartoon. It's like the elephant and the blind man. And you see, it has got everybody thinking. So we look at the properties, because these objects are so tiny that you don't observe them directly. If you want to find a mass of a salt or sodium iodide crystal, you can take a crystal and weigh it. But when you want to find a mass of a proton, it's difficult to take one proton and measure its size and so on directly. So we also make models. We have some understanding about how these particles interact with each other, or we have some guesswork hypothesis. So we, based on it, we make models. Then the models have a predictive power. They will say that if this is true, something should happen. Then we go and make the experiments. We make the experiments either using available natural resources like natural radioactive elements, or today with the technological advances with large accelerators and large detectors. And this data then analyzed. That means you sort out like a jigsaw puzzle and figure out what is going on. That's what a scientist does. So if you ask me, it's a very interesting game. It's really like playing a jigsaw puzzle. So let's now see, where did the nuclear physics begin? So if you go back in time, in 1896, the discovery of radioactivity, which was a big surprise because nobody thought that there could be such a phenomena will there, and that could be said as the beginning of the nuclear physics. Then Rutherford and his students, they actually came up with a concept of a nuclear atom. From their experiment, they said that nucleus is more particles than that, and that's how then the particle physics began. So the 1903 Nobel Prize in Physics was given to Henri Becquerel, Marie Curie and Pierre Curie for the discovery of radioactivity. Incidentally, I would like to say that the term radioactivity also was coined by Marie Curie. So father of nuclear physics, if you look at it, Rutherford is referred to as, because as I just said that he discovered the concept of from his experiment idea, you have to do work. But he had very, very good students who themselves went on to become later, make more fundamental discoveries. Now I told you that the atom itself is a very small. Now nucleus is even smaller inside the atom. So let us see how small is the the thing, because my network seems to be fine. Okay, so this was probably a network connection. So at what point it froze, if you tell me, I can repeat some part. Okay, all right. Okay, sorry about this, but this is a network issue which we can't help. Now let me get back my pointer. Yeah, so all right. So as I said, that the nucleus is a very, very small size object, so that it's like it's much, much, much higher. So if you made a coin of nuclear matter instead of the gold, it would weigh about 100 kiloton. 1 ton is 1,000 kg. Okay, so let's move on. So if I look at now inside the atom, as we understand today, what is the atom? You have a cluster of protons and neutrons, and electrons moving at much farther distance. But just to show this picture here, I show you on this slide, we're close to the nucleus. you have neutrons and proton. If you look at a mass difference between them, neutron is slightly heavier than a proton. The particle physicist and nuclear physicist will talk about mass in the units of energy. You would have heard that Einstein showed that mass and energy are equivalent. So the generally, the conventionally, nuclear and particle physicists therefore will talk of energy of the particles and masses also in the energy units. So nucleus has a force between neutron and proton, which is called strong force because it is stronger than the Coulomb repulsive force between like protons. Because otherwise, how do I put like charges, all positively charged protons, together in such a small size of a few Fermi? That's a small box of a size of a few Fermi. So, but then the question is that all neutron proton combinations are not stable. You have a hydrogen, which is the simplest nucleus with a single proton. Then you have hydrogens, heavier hydrogens like a deuteron, which is a proton neutron. You have a triton, which is a proton and two neutrons. But I can't make a hydrogen isotope with one proton and four neutrons and make it stay. So what decides? So these are the properties and interactions of these particles, neutrons and protons, which decides that it is how the things are, which nuclei are stable and which can be made. But there is one interesting thing which is the nature has given us, is because neutron is slightly heavier than proton and neutron itself is not stable. It undergoes, it can get converted into a proton. That's the process which is called a beta decay. And I mentioned this because this is what gave to the birth of the neutrino. So what happens is a neutron, if a free neutron is kept say in a table, then it will decay into proton and electron, and some energy which is equivalent to the mass difference of the two is carried out, carried by the electron. And since the radioactive decay are like a statistical process, which means it's like tossing a coin, you have a probability of getting a head or a tail. So here there is a probability, if I have 100 neutrons, there is a probability that each neutron can decay into proton or not decay. But what half-life means is if after that much time, if I come and count, I will have approximately half the number of neutrons. So if I started with 100 neutrons, after about 10 minutes, I will see on and on. I do such many experiments like that. I will see about 50, but it can vary. So the puzzle here was that when they measured the electron energy spectrum in this graph, which is shown, I have a number of electrons and this is the energy of the electron. This was not quite the neutron decay, but the decay of the bismuth, but the process is same, a neutron getting converted into proton. What was expected was, because the nucleus is very heavier, light particle, light electron which is coming out will take away all the energy and it should just come out with a single energy. Whereas it showed a distribution. And then that was very puzzling, because energy is one of the fundamental quantities which is conserved, which means energy is constant. I can change energy from one form to the other form, but I can't create or destroy. This is also something which we learn in the basics of thermodynamics, so you must have seen that. And if that is violated, if that is not true, then the life would be very, very different. What experiment today, what science I measure today will not be same if I do an experiment next week. And we know that that is not true, so the energy is conserved. So what could be happening? So then Pauli, after a lot of thought and after, because people did more experiments to ensure, and finally came up with this hypothesis that there is a third particle, not just a proton and electron, but I am creating a third particle. It is neutral, because if it had electrical charge, we would have detected it. So it is neutral and it is light, and somehow then of course the energy is shared between electron and neutrino, so depending on, and the total energy is constant. By 1933, and Pauli called it a neutrino because a small neutral particle. By mid-30s, then Fermi went ahead and built a theory saying that how this neutrino interacts, and then they said that neutrino is like electron, a spin half particle. A spin concept for the particles is difficult to imagine, but it's like an earth has a spin. It could envisage, they can conceptualize that these particles which are moving about themselves. So there are particles which have integral spin, which are called bosons, like photon, whereas all other particles, proton, neutron, electron and neutrino, have the spin half particle. But this was what I want to show here now is that in 1930s it was predicted, but it took 25 years 25 more years, only in mid-1950s, when actually experimentally this particle could be detected and say, aha, that's the thing, that neutrino really does exist. So before I tell you the story of the neutrino and the neutrino detection, let me just take one moment to tell you, many people are scared about radioactivity, but I want to tell you that the radioactivity is actually very, very important for the life to exist, because the radioactivity in the interior of Earth is one of the sources that's responsible for heat generation, which ionizes the material there, and these ions and motion of these ions gives rise to the geomagnetic field, which deflects solar wind, protecting Earth's atmosphere. So without radioactivity, the life would not have been possible. After the discovery of neutrino, and since I have short time, I can't go into the discovery of all the particles, but today, as we understand the standard model of the physics, which is one of the major successful model, has different families of particles. There are quarks, which undergo strong interactions, and then protons and neutrons are ultimately, and other particles are made out of that. They're also called hadrons. You have another family called leptons, which is the electron and its cousins, and for every lepton, like electron, muon, tau, there is a corresponding neutrino, corresponding partners. And since all these particles interact with different forces, there's a Coulomb force, of course, for which the electromagnetic force, and that's photon, is the carrier. For the weak interaction, that is the beta decay type interactions, you have different particles, and for the interactions among the quarks, there are gluons. Some of you may have heard in early part of the around 2012, the last missing puzzle, the Higgs boson, was discovered, and there are of course the gravitational forces, but when you talk about the particles interactions, that is much weaker than any of this, so we will not talk about that. So the picture is more or less complete here in terms of particles, but of course a lot more to be known. And now, while studying about how these neutrinos are, whether they have zero mass or they have non-zero mass, will open the windows to the physics beyond the standard model. Going into the details of it is beyond the scope of this lecture, but I hope to introduce you to the concept so that you people can go and look more visually. So coming back to the experiments with neutrino. So, as I said, the first detection came in 1956, and Cohen and Rhines made this experiment, and for which Rhines was awarded Nobel Prize in 1995. One of the major conditions, or the prime conditions for Nobel Prize, is that it's only given to the people who are alive. So unfortunately, Cohen missed it. And what was the experiment? It was a very simple experiment. They looked for the antineutrinos from the nuclear power plant, and then these antineutrinos captured by proton gave the signal. But because the neutrino interacts very, very weakly, these signals are very difficult to detect. You have a lot, it's like you have a room full of noise and you are trying to listen to some music. It doesn't work, right? You need to find the ways to get away from the crowd, or reduce the noise by shutting off the windows and things like that. What I want to emphasize is, if you see their experiment size, the detector size, they used about 400 liters of water. So if you know the typical, these days people put 1000 liter tanks in the house, like as an overhead water tank in the house, which is a loft tank, which is about 1000 liters. So this is even smaller than that. Rutherford's experiment was very small. Now you are getting slightly bigger of the size of the table. And in next couple of slides, we will really see now how big the detectors are. I'll take a moment here because I think it's very appropriate to talk about Madame Wu there. So as I said, energy is conserved. Another quantity, physical quantity, which is by and large conserved in most of the physics processes, is what is called the parity. The parity means, if you look at a mirror reflection, you know that the right-handed object turns into a left-handed. Your right hand appears like a left hand. So there are many molecules, many objects, like our body is not mirror symmetric, but the physical processes are mirror symmetric. So in mid-50s, it was observed that these interactions, weak interactions, which cause like processes like beta decay, do not conserve the parity. So that was also now a twist in the story. And Madame Wu, along with her colleagues, did this experiment, a very, very interesting and a very difficult, challenging experiment. is to show by studying the beta-decay in cobalt-60 that indeed the parity is not conserved in beta-decay. And some of you would have seen in the news that this year the US Postal Service released a stamp in her memory saying that during a career that spanned more than 40 years in a field dominated by men, she established herself as the authority on conducting precise and accurate research to test fundamental theories of physics. So kudos to Madam Bo. So now, where do the neutrinos come from? Neutrinos are there from, were created at the time of the Big Bang and which are still there. So these are also called relic neutrinos, which are there. Neutrinos come from the sun because inside the sun, four protons get converted into four helium. It's not a one-step process, but in many things it come in. And when the stars explode, which also have a lot of nuclear processes happening, so the neutrinos come from there. In addition to that, you have atmospheric neutrinos. And the first atmospheric neutrino was detected in India. You can look up all about it from the INO webpage. There are also cosmic rays. There are also neutrinos from Earth core, because I told you there's a radioactivity inside the in the Earth core. And there are neutrinos from man-made activities like particle accelerators and the reactors. So are we bumping into a neutrino? Every second, your body receives about 400,000 billion neutrinos from the sun, 50 billion neutrinos from natural radioactivity and from nuclear plants and so on. But what's more important is our body contains 20 milligrams of 40 potassium, which is radioactivity. So which is radioactive. So we emit about 340 million neutrinos a day, traveling nearly at a speed of light. So if ever you feel depressed, or if anybody is trying to tell you you don't know anything, remember, you, each one of you is a very scintillating personality. So what we want to learn, we have learnt a lot about neutrinos, we have detected different types and so on, but what we still do not know is how many types of neutrinos exist, is neutrino mass zero or not zero? Okay, to this we have an answer. And another question, which is a little technical, is are neutrinos their own antiparticles? So in nature, every particle has a partner, they come in the pair. And that is called the antiparticle. They have similar mass, they have similar interactions, but they have different charge. Because like energy can't be created, charge also cannot be created. So whenever you create a particle, you create, when you, from energy, when you create a thing, you create a particle antiparticle pair. So now you realize we all are made of matter. So when the universe started in the Big Bang, there should have been equal amount of antimatter. Where did all antimatter go? Why is there more matter than antimatter? Maybe there is some anti-universe somewhere else and anti-objects, like each one of our anti-partners are sitting somewhere else. We do not know, but that's not just a science fiction. But the question is why there is more matter than antimatter. So some of these questions are what we still try to address by building these big detectors in the cell scale. So as I just told you, when you want to study neutrinos, this, since they are very weakly interacting particles, we cannot just look at them on the surface detector. So like a noisy room, if I want to listen to a music, I have to shut the windows. So in this case, what you do is you go deep underground or you go inside the tunnel, so that because of the good rock coverage, if you have around 1 kilometer of rock coverage above the detector, all the majority of the cosmic ray muons can be reduced. So either you go deep in the mine or you go inside a tunnel, and you can find, this is a logarithmic plot, so this about, you can reduce the flux of the cosmic rays or the cosmic ray backgrounds by about a million times or more. How am I doing with time? Okay, I'll skip this part. So I want to show you this. This was a detector which looked at the solar neutrinos, and the study of the solar neutrinos showed that the neutrinos actually go from one type to the another type. They oscillate, and that can happen because they have a non-zero mass. So the reason of showing this detector is, now you look at the size of a detector. You have a human being standing here, and this is the detector. Yet it tells you how much of the water it is using. It's like in several thousand tons of water, and size of the detector is like three stories. This is another detector in Japan, which is a Kamiokande observatory. Now they have a super Kamiokande and hyper Kamiokande versions of it. Just look at it, the size of the detector, 50,000 tons of ultra pure water. And this, you will find more things inside the on the webpage, that if they have to do work on the detector, how do they work. So these men travel on inside the in a boat inside the huge water tank. So see, doing the science will be so much fun. So now coming to the and in 2015, Nobel Prize was given to McDonald and Kajita for proving from this thing that the neutrinos actually oscillate from one flavor to the other flavor. So what is India doing in this direction? There's a proposal to bring the India Neutrino Observatory, and a lot of work is happening on in that direction. So this will come up in the south of India, close to Madurai. It's a tunnel inside the mountain, so you will get about 1.3 kilometer of rock overburden, and this gives you an engineer's view of the cone. There will be three tunnels. There will be main experiment which will look at the atmospheric muon neutrinos. So what it will look at is that they study the atmospheric muon neutrinos and address issues about the neutrino masses, and why there is the preponderance of matter over antimatter. The more details about this you can see on the INO webpage, and I will leave you with that, just giving you the picture of the proposed detector. This will be the world's largest electromagnet. It will have detectors between the iron plates. The iron will give the electromagnet, and the detectors will detect muons, and the magnet will help you detect the positively and negatively charged muons separately. These are the pictures of some of the detectors already made in the both in Mumbai and Madurai, and this is actually how you can track by the signals in detector, make the cosmic ray muon track. And this is a picture of the mini iCal, the prototype, which is taking data currently at Madurai. So now I'm going to just take next 5 minutes or so and tell you about the other experiment in which I'm mainly involved, which is to probe the nature of the neutrino. Now it's known that neutrino has mass, but the question still remains open whether neutrino is its own antiparticle or not. And here we have two great scientists, Dirac saying neutrino and antineutrino are different, and Mehrana saying neutrino and antineutrino are same. Now when this happens, the only way you can distinguish is by doing some kind of experiment. The beta decay told us about neutrino's existence, and now nucleus again comes to our help and tries to tell us that we will go to the what is called a double beta decay. Maria Goeppert-Mayer, another nuclear physicist who also got a Nobel Prize for describing the nuclear shell structure or magic numbers in nuclei, predicted double beta decay. So that means some nuclei cannot undergo a single beta decay, because it is energetically, it is like going on the other, going other way around. But if two neutrons inside a nucleus simultaneously decide to convert to two protons, then the such a decay is possible. Now in this case, further therefore is suggested that if neutrino is its own antiparticle, then it's possible to have a process like this, which is called a zero nu beta beta, that is only two electrons come out and there is no neutrino. And how would I know this if the no neutrino is come out? Is that if I look at both these electrons and measure their energy precisely, if that is all that is coming out, no neutrinos, then from the energy of these two, I can say that, okay, that there is the phenomena is not this, but this. This will always happen. We want to see if this happens or not. If this happens, you will know neutrino is its own antiparticle, and you can also measure the mass of the neutrino. That is why the study of neutrino-less double beta decay is very important. And it also tells you that there is a physics beyond standard model, because this is the standard model does not predict neutrino and antineutrino to be same. So it will open up a new vistas for additional physics. Now look at this, the beta decay itself is a very weak process. Double beta decay is even weaker, its half-life is like 10 power 20 years. I told you the half-life of a neutron is about 10 minutes. Now consider with respect to that. And neutrino-less double beta decay is even weaker than double beta decay, with a half-life of longer than 10 power 24 years. So you need very, very novel experiments and large detectors, because the half-lives are long. So I need to start with large number of nuclei, which also so that some of them can decay. So what we plan to do is that we would like to make study the neutrinolase double beta decay in 1:20:14, and this will be a detector. In the long run, it should be like a 1-ton detector sitting at a millikelvin temperature, at a very low temperature, with a cryogenic detector. The concept is very simple. You have a detector and a sensor, and you keep the whole thing at a low temperature. So when the double beta decay happens, two electrons will come out, and because you're sitting at low temperature, if the heat capacity is low, it will result in a measurable temperature change. You measure the temperature change, and you can therefore measure the energy. This is very analogous to the school experiment which all of you would have done in a copper beaker, adding hot water and measuring the thing. It's just that, but you do it at a millikelvin temperature. So that is what makes it more challenging. And to measure such low temperature, you need special sensors. We make it out of semiconductors, so that the semiconductor resistance is very high at low temperature. So any small change in temperature will change the resistance exponentially, and you can measure it. So this is the setup in the TFR where you can achieve millikelvin temperature. This is called the dilution refrigerator. Again, you can look up the details on the webpage. These are the various stages in preparing the thermal sensors, and these are some of the test results. These are the people who are working in that. You can see they all enjoy what they are looking or doing. They all look very happy. And then I should just add, they're probably more happier because I was not in the lab. So to summarize, I would like to say what neutrinos can tell us is we will, from the neutrino mass, tells us that we need revision in our current understanding. Neutrinos are also messengers from the farthest parts of universe, because we are seeing neutrinos right from the Big Bang time. We still need to understand why there is more matter than antimatter and how many types of neutrinos exist. Now, before I stop, I want to tell a couple of slides about the women physicists in India. So the first, I think some of you would have heard about Bibha Chowdhury now, because she's been in the news for last couple of years. She was the first woman particle physicist in India. With D.M. Bose, she did experiments on the study the mesons, and actually their experiment, and published in a very, very prestigious journal, Nature. Their work actually paved the way for discovery of meson, for which Powell got Nobel Prize, and he actually acknowledges their experimental technique. Her biography was published in 2018, and we are bringing out an Indian edition of this biography. This will be released on 8th March. So this is also a small advertisement for this book. Coming to the current era, many of you would have heard of Rohini Godbole. She is working at IISc, and she has done a pioneering work in standard model and beyond standard model physics at colliders. She is the first woman physicist who was honored with Padma Award a couple of years ago. She has also brought out a book, Leelavati's Daughters, along with Professor Ram Ramaswamy. And this list about gives you stories of many Indian women scientists. So I thought it was appropriate to show it in this forum. And since we are talking of INO, the women scientists in INO, there's Dr. Indumati, Professor Shubhavati Goswami, Professor Neeta Sinha, Sandhya Chobe, and myself. And if you look at the INO graduate program, so far there have been actually a very large number of women students, almost a 50-50, a good ratio. Now, before I stop here, sorry, my cursor is misbehaved. Oh God. 1 minute. I wanted to tell you a short story. Why I cannot get my cursor. Just okay, I'm really sorry about this. Yeah. Why my cursor is gone away? Okay, now I can see it. Yeah. So of course I would like to thank the collaborations, which is the INO and the Tintin collaboration giving me that. But I want to say one small piece of story here, that 4 decades back, I actually attended lectures at Nehru Science Center, given by people like Professor Chitre and other scientists from TIFR. That was one of the motivating factors for me to pursue the science. So I am very sure that from the people from the audience today, sooner and not very late in another decade, will be pursuing participating in these mega projects and be successful scientists and will motivate people further. Thank you. Juma?
Yes.
Yeah, sorry. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, ma'am, for this wonderful presentation. Now I'd like to take the questions. Is there any questions from the participant in Zoom? Then let's see if there is any question. You can post in the chats as well. Okay, there is one question from here. Archita is asking, what are the prospects of a high energy physicist at INO and when the INO is expected to be fully functional?
Okay, good question. The prospects for high energy physicists at INO are unlimited because the opportunities are both. There is a lot of science to be done. There is a lot of the detector which I showed you requires. Okay, let me go back to the detector slide. Just give me a minute. I don't know why this my arrow has become a problem. Okay, so let me go back to the detector slides so that I can explain to you what is there, because I didn't have much chance to, didn't go in details there. Yeah, so when you look at it, for example, you are building a large size detector, so it has engineering aspects, it has a lot of electronics because you have to make the detector readouts, and these detectors also take data over long time, like many years. So then there is an analysis, so there's a lot of electronics work, there's a lot of mechanical work, and there's also a lot of physics which you approach, then you will tune your experiments to doing the physics. So the prospects are very very high. Now the next question is, when is INO expected to be fully functional? See, these are the these things have many facets, so usually also these things are built in phases. And it depends on the many constraints. There are technological challenges. There are also funding issues which come in. So the process, the actual execution depends on many of these things. Of course, INO is fully funded. And right now, there are also, in case of INO, there are some environmental challenges. So getting the place and the tunnel ready would be some time. But yes, it is the work has not stopped, and there is a lot of R&D in progress. So in fact, people can join in to do the summer projects and even the short term projects. Even the undergraduate students at that level join in. Please visit the INO webpage and the Tintin webpage for more information on this.
Okay, we have one question from one of our visitors. What is singularity?
Sorry, can you please repeat?
What is singularity?
Okay, what is singularity? Now, singularity is a kind of a concept where the when you say a point, you have a point which is a zero. In an axis, I have a line and then I have a point which goes to the zero. So the singularity is kind of a point where all the dimensions, everything goes to zero. And we believe the universe evolved from such a singularity because that's how it came out of a nothing and so on. So in the gravitation and for the understanding the concept, this evolution of the stars, and the black holes, that's a very important the singularity and the properties of the singular black hole or the objects at the singularity play an important role.
Okay, time for next question. Okay, someone is asking that the data storage system really looks too big. How do you convert this data in the form of images, or how do you decode this huge data in readable information?
I did not show you the data storage system. This is a detector. This is the detector through which the particles are going. And then it will be like a gas detector. You may have heard of GM counter. What is a detector? Our eye is a detector, right? We see the light. So these are only detectors which I showed you. Of course, the data volume will be large and the data will be stored on high performance computers, high performance servers, and will be analyzed there. Because if I have, like, for example, if I can probably show it here. Let me go back. Yeah, if you see this is just a track through 8 detectors. Now when you have thousands of detectors and 10,000 particles going in, you need to do a lot of processing. So this is the detector. Because of a signal, I know that this particle hit here, this particle hit here, and that is how you will create a track. So now if you want to create a trajectory of the particle for a long, over long distance, then from the curvature you will know what is the energy of the particle. Depending on which way it is bending in the magnetic field, you will know it is positively charged or a negatively charged. So that's the kind of thing. So these are detectors, and the data will be stored in the computers. Maybe now the cloud computing is taking over, it will go in the cloud, I do not know. And that is where the technological developments has helped immensely in both, like, accelerators, detectors, analysis, even theoretical calculations require a use of large computers.
Okay, we have another question. Can it also be used to detect dark matter particles or axions?
Very good question. Yes, some of these detectors can be used for detecting dark matter, particularly the neutrinoized double beta decay detectors, and dark matters can be easily used. Even in INO, there are programs to study the dark matter, because when you say dark matter, that is not directly visible to you. So you look for its interaction and look for the interaction product. So these things are like you are, say, playing billiard balls. Somehow you don't see the primary ball, but because when it kicks or it hits something, it will give you a second question. Is there any promising application of machine learning in the data analysis of INO? Certainly. See, all these analysis which are voluminous have to be have the scope of doing it in with a machine learning, and the new techniques coming in also help us to look for smaller and finer effects.
Okay, someone is asking about the neutrino flavors and its purpose.
Okay, neutrino flavors. As I showed in the slide, there are different families of particles. Let me just go back to that slide. So there are quarks, there are leptons, and then there are fermions. So if I look at the leptons family, I have three particles, electron, muon, and tau. And each of them have a corresponding neutrino. So these are the flavors of this. So these are so it's like in a one big family, there are three small families. These are the flavors. Now, in case of neutrino, what happens is you have, even within neutrino, there are two families. So these are called the electric flavor families, and then there are mass flavors. So that each of these can be, it's like a circular polarized light is made of different linearly polarized lights, like that. Each of these neutrino, that is why as the neutrinos propagate, as light propagates through media, the circular polarization changes. So here also, as the neutrinos propagate through media, they can change. So that is why they can change from one flavor to the other flavor. And this is also seen in the other spin up particles, but that is there. So these three are at least known, which is coming in. Now the concept is that, like a sterile neutrinos, because since they do not have a charge, if there are additional things, unless you took them from some interaction, we do not know. So that's where it is not yet confirmed that there are only these three flavors. There, if there are more flavors, that is the open question. So we know they have mass. We don't know whether they are its own antiparticles, and we don't know how many flavors are there. So the fourth category is called the sterile neutrino, because they do not have the counterpart. You are not seeing them. You have to see them again through the indirect processes.
Okay, we have another question. Why have you chosen the Theni village in Tamil Nadu, and is there any radiation hazards in this project?
Okay, we have chosen Tenali in Tamil Nadu because you need a place where you want to, you can get a good overhead cover, right? Because I need to have about a kilometer of mountain. Let me get back to the picture. Yeah, so you need about, for the detector, you should sit around below the 1 kilometer earth. Now there are other considerations which you have to look at. Is that the place should be approachable? You also, because you need to have exposed to the more radiation. As I told you that we already have some radioactive, minute amount of radioactivity inside us. If we go through a dentist to get an x-ray, that exposes you to much more radiation. Here you are detecting neutrinos which are hardly interacting with anybody. So you do not know. So there is no radiation hazard associated, but since this question was asked, let me show you. So this is the radiation in daily life thing which is there. So if you look at, for example, when you go for a chest scan, you go for the x-rays, what are the kind of radiations you receive? And every time you take a plane, you receive a significant amount of those because you go at a high altitude. But when we take a flight and go, we don't think about it. So, of course, because there are things which we cannot avoid, which are there. But so if you look at this, is the thing. So here you are only looking at the muons which are coming in. You go underground, you are even reducing the muons. So it's an anti-plane. Now, instead of going high up, you are going down. And you are only looking at what is naturally radiation which is there, which are particles which don't even interact with you. So there is no additional radiation hazard. That's a misconception.
Okay, someone is asking why the light does not bend in neutron star but in black hole, because a neutron star also have high gravitational and magnetic pull.
Yeah, but the black hole is much stronger. Because of the black hole has a much stronger gravitational field, so that is why it bends. But otherwise, the normal gravitational fields don't play any role in the particle physics. Yeah.
Okay, a question from one.
Ghost particle, because it's very difficult to see, it's been elusive, right? Because I said that it took 25 years to find it. Experimentally detected. So because it interacts so less, it is just passing through you all the time. And it's, so if you put a detector also, it just passes through that. So it's difficult to detect. So it's called ghost particle. Of course, to match it, the Higgs boson was called God's particle. So that's also part of the reason. But it's called ghost because mainly difficult to detect.
Okay, I don't see any more questions. Okay. So I want to thank Professor Nanal for this wonderful lecture and good interaction. I hope people have got enough information and they can also visit the INO website for details as well. I want to thank the audience as well for showing their curiosity, asking questions. I hope many more active participation from the others, because our lecture is ongoing. Also, we have another lecture at 4 p.m. today, so don't miss that. Thus, I want to thank Professor Nanal again. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.